What's up, everybody? It's Tuesday night. That means it's time for the Sesh. What's up, Peter Martin?
What's up, Adam? How you been, man? I haven't seen you since last Tuesday.
I was going to say, didn't we do this yesterday?
Didn't we talk like 90 minutes ago?
I think That's I awesome, remember man. Something. Yeah, how's it going?
It's good. Yeah, how are you doing?
Pretty good. I am so excited for tonight. We've had some rare seshes where we get to have... Oh, there's football talk going on.
Okay. Well, I'm still smarting from the Saints and Drew Brees, whatever. But what's up, Bill? It's all good, man. It's all good.
No, so we've had a couple of sessions now where we've got to have the artists that we're listening to come on, and we get to awkwardly parade them around while they listen to their own
virtually,
music.
Virtually.
Right. It's fantastic. Yeah. We listened to Joshua Redman's Beyond. We had that whole band on.
Joshua who?
Joshua Redman.
Right.
Did Hutch join us? No, Hutch didn't join us. He was in.
Hutch fell asleep because he was 6 hours ahead in.
We can't say.
Oh yeah, at an undisclosed location in the Eurozone.
just recently, we listened to the Ray Brown Trio live at Starbucks, and we had the great Jeffrey Keyser on to talk about that band.
Yeah.
Again, Hutch a no show for that. Come on, Hutch.
Oh, that's true.
Come hang, man.
Maybe he'll show up tonight. That would be super awkward.
So tonight we are listening to, first of all, we're listening to an album that came out in 2020.
Yeah.
Which is, this is the second, I think it's the second album. This is the first one. I think
this is the first album.
This is the first album we've listened to in
2020. Yeah, this is the first album.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, the first album that we listened to?
In 2020?
Yeah. Hey, Adam, my name's Peter. How you doing, man?
All right, let's
my name's Peter Martin. Good to meet you. This is called The Sesh.
You get what you pay for here, folks. So, so we're listening to some pretty fairly new music. I remember sitting in a bar listening to this music with you in 2019. So
that's what's throwing you off. And it was late. It was like November or December 2019.
Which I was thinking about
it. Both feels like a decade ago and a month ago. We're not sure which one it was.
So we're listening to... Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that it's one of my... most recent, and you know what, dog? Why don't you just shut up? Who are you growling at? Either come over here. These dogs, man. Pandemic. It's a pandemic, you damn dog. Okay, relax. This was one of my most recent joyful memories of listening to live music with you, with anybody here in St.
You are
St.
reading
Louis.
My mind, man.
You know what I mean?
I was just thinking about this. I was like, why does this music stand out to me so much as so fresh? I think it's because it was the last really, truly great concert I saw before the world closed down was ARTEMIS, who we're listening to tonight.
Right. Now, we did see about five other gigs after that together, and they all sucked.
They were not,
remember that?
Not so great. Not so great. No, but for really, I mean, I don't know about you, but, and I love this album, but seeing this group live was just, I was just mind blown the whole time. It was so intense and so good.
Yep.
And at every chair in the band is such a high quality. And
some of them are standing actually, but we're going to get into all that. We're going to ask them about that. They're going to explain all that.
Totally.
And so ARTEMIS, we're blessed. And you know what, dog?
Yeah,
I will put you out on the street back to where from whence you came. Do you hear me?
I love about the Seshes is how chill they are.
The Seshes are super high strung all
chill.
Of a sudden.
I know. What's going on?
The ARTEMIS is recording came out in September, just this past September, and it's been on heavy rotation around the house here for me, and I know for a lot of folks. And so we're really excited. So can we bring on the artist of ARTEMIS?
Yeah, so check it out.
Okay.
We have Rini Rosnes right here.
Rini Rosnes!
We have Anat Cohen.
Anat
right
Cohen!
We have Noriko Ueda right here on the
Noriko!
Bill. Isn't that cool? How cool is that? How's it going?
You guys are so funny.
Anat's like, you guys are so funny. This is the most unprofessional interview we've done since September. Well, you know what?
Yeah.
That's what happens when you're 4 months into a new album release. You start making the rounds, you know?
I was thinking, my first question for ARTEMIS is, what is it like to release an album like this where you have to do these virtual these virtual hangs with some jokers like us. This is it must be really, that must be a really interesting process here.
This is great. It's the best part. So you get to hang and without leaving the house.
Oh, that
That's
is
right.
Nice.
That's right.
Yeah, we wish obviously that we could be out supporting the album, playing live, and we had a lot of dates scheduled, and you know, obviously everything got canceled. So, you know, we're hoping that the momentum can still be there in some degree when we come back to life again, and we can still carry on and not only promote the record, but by then we should have about 2 more records worth of music stored up.
Oh, that's so good.
That's
to hear.
Right.
You made
right.
such a beautiful piece of art here, and I can't wait to hear this band live again. I wanted to go back the next week after y'all played here in St. Louis. So.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah, we had such a great time at St. Louis. In St. Louis to play, you guys were there for the whole night, sitting in the bar, sipping
right.
water. It was great.
Sipping water,
when
yep.
was it?
Mm-hmm.
Was it the last year or the...
Yeah, it was November 2019, yeah.
Yeah. It feels like 10 years ago.
It does feel like 10 years ago.
I know.
I think I erased all the last year, so I feel like it's like, you know, yeah.
Well, we were
really
counting.
Memory.
Yeah, we were saying this was like March, you know, 287th, but I lost count. And so I finally reset into January of 2021, you know.
Yeah.
But you know what I was thinking? I'm super excited, even having heard the record a lot and enjoyed it a lot, is to listen to this with you guys and with the listeners, because I think that, you know, we forget not only during the pandemic, but even before, maybe the last 5 to 10 years, we forget how many great records are still being made. I mean, there's some bad records too. We all know that. But I mean, for one thing,
I feel like
I know
that was a shot at me, buddy.
No, it was not at all. Come on, man. Come on. No, but I mean, we've been doing our little part here on Tuesdays to kind of get back to the thought process and the listening process of just sitting and listening to a whole album. And so it's easy to go back to the 50s, the 40s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, all these different periods. And we've done that to some great classic records. But I actually love doing recent records, great documents that have happened, because there's always great music happening and experiencing that as well. And we've done it a little bit. We haven't done a lot. But I'm super excited to dive into what I think is going to be like a new classic, basically.
Mm, agreed.
Ooh, thank you. Thank you.
So let's listen to a little bit of music, and then maybe we could talk about how Artemis came to be. Does that sound okay?
Sure.
Cool. So this first track here, sort of a title track, Goddess of the Hunt, as Artemis is the Greek goddess of the hunt. So let's check it out. Thank you. It's a composition by drummer Allison Miller, Goddess of the Hunt. That, Peter, how many times have we talked about during this series, this listening session series of opening tracks and how important they are on albums? As we've listened to all these complete albums and how important it is to really to set the table. And this is one of those. It's one of the great opening tracks in recent memory.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's, you know, normally we'd say, okay, you don't want to give the drummer's tune first. But in this case, Allison, this is such a great tune. And I mean, it's got, you know, it's so adventurous, but it's got such a strong groove. I think it's a great choice. And Rini, I always love your comping, and I'm partial to the Pianist, of course. But you just have some genius. Every time I hear this, it's fun because I hear new things, and it's mixed so well that you're coming in and out of it, and just some brilliant comping. And Noriko, I think the bass, I'm in love with your bass playing, but I think it was captured really well on this recording, the engineering. Who was the engineer on this?
James Farber.
Oh, Farber, of course. Well, that explains it.
That explains it.
But it was wonderful. No, I was just going to say it was wonderful because he had also worked with many of us individually, so he already knew our playing. So that I'm sure that really helped going into it.
Absolutely. But I mean, you know, as great as Farber is, he has to have great material to work with, which obviously he did here. So that's a cool thing. What was it like for you guys? I know, Rini, you worked on Blue Note, you know, many times, different projects and stuff. But what was that like doing with this band on Blue Note Records, and like how did that work into the process? I know you've got at least one kind of classic cover, Blue Note cover on here, a great rendition that we're going to hear of Sidewinder soon. But Anat, I don't know if you or anybody wants to kick it off, but just I know it's always a special thing being a part of the Blue Note family.
Anat? It's such a good girl. I mean, really, it's been around on Blue Note. For me, it's the first album on Blue Note, and of course, this is so much history and pressure, but going rehearsing with the band and be getting familiar along the past previous 3 years playing with the band, it was just a nice lead to the time in the studio. And it was once you start playing and you really focus on the music, it's you don't think about it. Until Rini brought the Sidewinder, of course, that was kind of reminded us where we are and in history.
Yeah,
but right. Very exciting, very exciting.
That's so cool.
That's cool.
It's like a dream comes true moment for me. Yeah, when I heard the name of Bruno's record, what? You know, it's a really amazing feel.
So Peter,
awesome.
I don't know if you've seen, but Rini's already done one of these sessions for Blue Note. It's really hip. Everybody should check it out. If you want another listen of this, it's
on. Well, we'll see how ours goes.
We'll see how ours goes.
We might jump up to number one, but we'll see.
No, but she's doing your dream of spinning it on vinyl on a turntable, and that's
okay.
Yeah,
so that's gonna be better than this.
No. We'll do our part here. So I'm curious, before we listen to Frida, if someone wants to just talk about the origins of ARTEMIS.
Well, it really began in 2016 when there was a European promoter asked me to help him to put together a band of all women to celebrate Women's Day in March 2016. And we did two concerts, one in Paris and one in Luxembourg. And it was almost the same band. We had Linda O on bass and Terry Lynn Carrington on drums at that time. And then we just had such a great time playing together, and it was a really successful concert. And we just thought, you know, let's do some more. This just feels really good. Mm-hmm. And so then in 2017, Noriko came on board and Allison Miller came on board. And then we made a tour with Cecile, of course, as well, all over Europe in the summer. We hit the summer festival route. And, you know, I think it was really during that tour that we decided, you know, we want to keep playing together, and why don't we find a name for the group and keep it going when we get back to the States? Let's continue to play together. Because we just, you know, it started off, of course, being, okay, this producer wanted to have an all-woman band. That's where it did start, but that's not why it continued. It continued because we enjoyed playing together, and I love everybody's playing, and I think we all get along really well, and we just, you know, it just clicked. It clicked. Mm. So, you know, the decision to continue, you know, was really more about the music and the musicians rather than anything to do with gender.
Mm. Yeah, you can tell the chemistry is real. It comes across in the music big time. Yeah. Should we continue listening here?
Yeah, and I just want to add real quick to what was just said. I think that's so important, Rini, what you said, because we've all been involved in either all-star bands or bands that are tribute to this festival or, you know, tribute to Thelonious Monk. And it's sometimes it's great and sometimes the chemistry is kind of funny. And I love the fact that, woo, put your twigs in the air. But I love the fact that, like you said, you know, you guys made, and I figure that's what it was. You can hear that and feel that you guys made the decision to be like, that's great when the musicians are able to do that and say, you know what, this is something that was not just, yeah, it was put together as a one-time thing, but because the music was happening, the chemistry was there, and you felt it, that you were the impetus to continue it along. And I think that's probably a big part of why you've gotten these great performances and we have this beautiful album that came out of it.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Let's listen to some music. Hey, before we do, if you're in the
it's
audience,
it's always the
here,
piano player that has to hold things together. By the way, you notice that?
There's going to be a lot of that tonight, folks.
Of course,
just so you know. Before we get back to the music, if this is something that you're digging, let's let some more people know about it. Go ahead and hit that like or share right now, and let's listen to the rest of this record with an even larger group. Eh? Cool. Let's do it.
Yeah.
This is Frida. This is a Melissa Aldana composition. No.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yep.
Nope, that's just me. Here we go.
It's all about him.
Thank you.
That's Melissa Aldana's composition, Frida, from ARTEMIS's self-titled 2020 release. That's just beautiful. I'm a sucker for, Anat, the bass clarinet playing on this is so beautiful, and I'm such a sucker for it. I think I just lost my light. Everything's kind of going wrong tonight, Peter. I don't know what's going on, man. There's some grandma.
Oh, you look great. You look like a floating head there. It's awesome.
Yeah,
no, so, I agree that the bass clarinet, beautiful. I mean, the regular gorgeous. Clarinet, as it were, everything. And it's the nice comping again.
It's nice that the girls, the cats let me experiment my bass clarinet, which is it's a new beast for me. And I brought it for the session. I'm like, I'm going to play something. So you guys hit me.
It works, yeah.
Yeah, well, I think right. You guys already, even on the second tune on this record, you've hit such a nice balance between, you know, some experimenting, not only in the, you know, with the instruments, but the way that you guys are playing and interacting. There's so much listening going on. Noriko, your playing is so beautiful. The intonation, the left hand with Rini, so many great things happening. Mm-hmm. And we're always talking about great records that we listen to here are rewarded. And I would recommend everybody obviously pick this up, stream it and all that, but listen to it. Take the track, listen to the whole thing like we're doing tonight together, but then go back and listen. You will be rewarded with details, because I know I have been, and really appreciate that.
For sure.
You guys are so cool.
Mm-hmm. I can't hear you, Noriko. Wait, we're going to...
Really?
There you go.
Hello?
We got you.
Now we got you.
Oh, yeah, so I love playing the, you know, the line, like a melody, you know, with left-handed piano, and Yeah, me and Rini are looking at each other, and you know, I'm always smiling for that. And of course, Anat's bass clarinet added, and it's really, really beautiful. I really like that. Yeah.
Awesome. Now, someone had a question here that I thought was interesting. Yeah, this. Dave was saying, I'd be interested in some comments about doing focused listening of your own work. Yeah, I was wondering the same thing, because you guys are doing great, like digging. I know I have a lot of problems sometimes listening to stuff that I recorded, even things that people say they liked. How is this for you guys? And I know you've done this in some other formats to go through, Rini, if you want to start, you know, just like, what is it like for you to go back and just listen to yourself and listen to the music that you created?
You mean tonight, listening
tonight,
with you all?
Yeah.
Well, it's fun. I haven't actually listened to the album in a while. You know, we were doing some press, a lot of press things, so I was hearing tracks on the radio and whatnot, doing interviews, but I haven't heard it in a while. And it sounds fresh. It's very pleasant to go back and listen to it. And like you said, I also hear things I may not have heard, you know, so clearly before. You do discover new things upon listening, even though, you know, you spent all that time in the studio mixing and where you thought it was, you know, okay, I can't listen to this ever again in life. And then, but after 2 months goes by, you know, or a year even, you know, you do still find enjoyable moments that you maybe perhaps didn't hear so well before.
Mm, that's now. When did you guys record this? Was it 2019?
Yeah, it was September.
Okay. September, okay. So you got a little more than a year. Yeah, I always find that after you definitely need that separation from, especially if you're involved with the mix. It's like, it doesn't matter how great the music is. It's like, get it away.
Yeah.
So you just know all the jokes. You know everything that's going to happen. It's not as much fun.
Yeah.
And you're dealing with technicality, where, you know, it's becoming less about the music and the interaction are more about like analysis of like, you know, what should be. And you think about the music from a different angle. And then once you can let that go a few months later, suddenly you hear the music again. And you know, to be able to shift the focus, especially songs that you play live and mm-hmm. what happened every time something else happens, and then in catch something in such a clear way and hear everything that you suppose that is happening in the in the tune again, to be inside the band and like, oh, it's exciting actually. To bands, you always hear new things.
When you're working on the recording, I liken it to it's like looking at an x-ray, and then when you get away from it and you just come back to it for enjoyment, it's more like a painting.
Oh, that's great.
Nice.
Yeah.
So let's listen to some more music. Next up is an arrangement of the Beatles' The Fool on the Hill. This is an Ingrid Jensen arrangement, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Let's check it out. Thank you.
Beautiful, beautiful. Incredible.
That's The Fool on the Hill. That's an Ingrid Jensen arrangement, of course. That has her fingerprints all over it.
Exactly.
You know?
Totally.
Trumpet on top.
Yeah. That's so cool. Some good questions here, Peter. We have a smart crowd, I have to say.
We do.
It's a friend of the show here, Rob Endicott.
What's up, Rob?
Says, ensemble playing is beautiful. I'd be interested in Anat's thoughts on the horn section ensemble playing. Who leads and does that change? And how do you think about phrasing, articulation, etc.? It's a good question.
Excellent question. Well, I think in a natural, well, specifically on this song, obviously we're following Ingrid since she had the idea of the melody and the way she, traditionally, let's say, if you think about the three horns and you would follow the trumpet in a big band and you know, the trumpet has the piercing and, you know, I'm trying to imitate her and at least I get to hold it together from the bottom. But it depends who has the melody in general. So usually whoever has the melody or has the leading line will try to make the three of us sound like one instrument and let that person just shine enough so we can support. So I think being a home player, and it's funny because I always think about the different roles in a band between when you're a rhythm section and, you know, especially in this arrangement, the rhythm section is holding certain grooves, and then we get to like, we almost have like a separate conversation. It's like we're all like walking around together, and then suddenly it's like, you know, it's split into two groups, and then the rhythm section is talking about one thing, and we're like, I said, no, I said, we're like hanging, and it's a challenge because we have different sounds, but then we influence by each other's ideas, so there's like a lot of like imitations and call and response, and then like, all right, oh yeah, let's join back the other guys, and then we kind of go back, and we're moving on to the drum solo. So it's like, it's really, really cool. And Allison, I see Allison is here.
The rest of the band just showed up here.
You got a couple you got a couple of trolls in the comments. Look at that. No, not him. There you go. Ingrid.
Yeah.
Ingrid. Nice. We're talking about you guys.
That's right. Since they showed up, they get to control the narrative. That's the way it works.
Yeah, isn't that right? So earlier or not, you mentioned bringing the bass clarinet in and hoping that you could, you know, into the studio and you could work it in. How much of this, I mean, I know in any kind of all-star group like this, how much of this is had been worked out on the bandstand beforehand or arranged? Obviously, Ingrid's arrangement is fairly elaborate, but are you still coming into the studio and allowing some space like that? Some of this sounds like it is.
Absolutely. I mean, a lot of things are worked out. As in the studio, you have the magnifying glass of like being under the magnifying glass, since you're like all exposed, so everything you play, suddenly you're like, you have a chance to fine tune a lot of things and to rediscuss and renegotiate certain lines and certain voicings. And there's always something that's you missed before you might want to, you know, add or take out. So yeah, there's a lot of adjusting in the studio, definitely. A lot of flexibility by everybody.
It's awesome. Allison says, listening to our album makes me want to play.
Yeah.
I think it's making all of us want to play a little bit. Yeah.
I know. I can imagine it makes you guys. It makes all of us want to play.
Us too, Allison.
That's great. Let's move on. This is Big Top. Rini, this is one of your compositions. Yeah.
Right.
Anything you'd like to set it up with?
Sure. Well, I did kind of take you to a circus, I guess. So a three-ring circus with different sections, and we just have a lot of fun with this piece. So.
Hey, listen, if it's outside of my living room, I'm down to go. So here's Big Top. Thank you.
Yeah. That's killer. Ooh.
Swing so it.
What are we always talking about? Hold up. What are we always talking about, Adam? Once you get to the middle of the album, I know we're quite there yet. You get to the meat. You get to the gravitas. Like the. I mean, it's all been great, but this is Rini. Congrats on that. You're playing.
Yeah.
You know, and I think you're definitely channeling some Mingus, and then on your solo Monk and Herbie, but mostly just Rini, just classic.
Yeah. It's just out of this world.
Thanks.
Now, were you guys walking a bass line together for a little bit there?
Yeah, at the start of Melissa's solo.
That's so cool. Yeah, I love that. Cool. I didn't catch that until this listening. How did that come about?
It was just part of the arrangement.
Oh, that's so cool. I'm stealing that. I mean, I'm going to develop a concept that is parallel to that, but not the same.
Well, I wonder if you would talk a little bit about putting together the track list and some, if we can get some insights on what that's like to put together. I mean, it's similar, I know, to put together a set, but how do you go about putting together an album order?
Well, you know, I wanted to have everyone represented as a composer or an arranger. So that was the first thing. And then I just kind of trusted that everyone was going to come in with something that would make the whole album cohesive. And it kind of worked out, you know. I know that we also had Cecile's pieces to add in there too, which lent another vibe to the album. But I was very grateful to Anat for bringing in her beautiful ballad, because that was much needed as well. But it was, you know, we got together and we shared all our compositions with one another. And also Noriko's great waltz, which we didn't have anything else like that on the record either. So I think everyone was represented very well. And because we're a band that plays together and we have a cohesiveness anyway, I think that just, you know, ran through the music. It sounded cohesive because we play it cohesively.
Yeah. Mm. And when you're putting together like the order, are you thinking about, well, it's the middle, maybe we put like big top here because it's got that, you know, it's swinging right there in the middle.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. You know, where do you place the ballads? And we need the great opening track. I loved opening with Goddess too, because it featured everybody. So everybody, you know, we're kind of introducing the whole band. Here we all are, you know. Yeah, definitely. I always, and I think about keys, you know, tempos, all the normal stuff everyone thinks about when they're putting together a record. You want it to have a nice balance.
Yeah, not everybody thinks about that, just to let you know.
Oh, you don't think about what
you said? Really?
Well, I mean, everybody on Reedy's, on all you guys' level that you guys play with, come out into the middle of America. That's not the way it always works.
Let's just say. Buddy, come on now. You're so hard on yourself.
No, but I think the level, the way that you guys are thinking about it, I mean, is great. And week in and week out, we've been listening to some classic records here, and it's like that attention. Yeah, the playing is going to be there, the tunes, the arrangements, you got great musicians, but that attention to detail is rewarded when we sit and listen to an album from beginning to end as it unfolds. Of course, we have to like get in the way and talk about it in between each track, totally killing the vibe, that's, you know, and the momentum, great. But other than that, I think you can feel it for sure.
Well, speaking of Cecile McLaurin-Salvant, here is...
is there a vocalist on this record?
There's a vocalist on two tracks on this, and this is a tune by a little known singer songwriter named Stevie Wonder. This is "If It's Magic," and
your arrangement, right,
Rini? This is your arrangement.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, this is so beautiful.
Arranged by Rini Ronsnes, and this is "If It's Magic."
If it's magic, then why can't it be everlasting? Like the sun that always shines, like the poet's endless rhyme, like the galaxies in time. If it's pleasing, the day that never fails. Like on seashores there are shells. Like the time that always tells. It holds the key to every heart throughout the universe. It fills. Special, then with it, why aren't we as careful as making sure we dress in style, posing pictures with a smile, keeping danger from a child. It holds the key to every heart throughout the universe. It fills you up without a bite and quenches every thirst. So, if it's magic, why can't we make it everlasting? Like the lifetime of the sun, it will leave no heart undone, for there's enough for
everyone. Absolutely gorgeous. Just
beautiful.
Gorgeous.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
I want to talk about
what a great arrangement. Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Adam.
No, can we just have a little Cecile appreciation moment for a second? Just, she can sing a song.
She can. And man. But you know what? I Cecile's amazing in her reading of this, which is this is such a great song. It's a hard song to sing with the lyrics and to pull off. And I would just say also, Rini, on your arrangement, you really helped things along beautifully. And I mean, you played so much of the original heart part, actually. And like, you stuck to it until you didn't. It just, oh. And you know, yeah. I play this and I'm like doing all these silly reharmonies. I'm getting rid of all that. I'm going back to the original. Like, no. Rini, come on.
That's very the most simply beautiful understated arrangement. This is perfect for the song, Rini. Congratulations.
Yeah.
That harp on the original recording is so beautiful. That made it.
Yeah. And then when you bring the horns in, I mean, it's like a choir and it's so simple and beautiful. And then you nail so many people play this and screw up the form and don't go back to the bridge right away, which is really part. I mean, I've heard Stevie, you know, do this live many times. He always, that's the way the tune is,
right.
You know, and people try to treat it like a standard, like an AABA form.
Right.
It's beautiful.
We definitely didn't need solos, you know, the whole right. piece is a solo.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
This great is just stuff. for you and not from Chris. More bands need clarinet. Just trying to get you work, buddy.
I agree. I'm free until 2027.
No. No, you're not.
Things you only hear when, like, Anat Cohen is around. More bands need clarinet. See, yeah. That's, Anat, you think that's said a lot because people say that around you a lot. That's actually not said in the world very often.
Well, speaking of Anat.
I know. Yeah. Okay, we're not going to get into the stuff I heard about the clarinet in my days. which happened last year. Okay.
So yeah. Nocturno is next. That's yours. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit about it?
It's a ballad, like Rini said, and I figured nobody's gonna bring a ballad. I'm gonna bring a ballad.
I'm gonna slay him with my ballad.
I got this ballad.
I tortured myself in finding how to play, and then I was trying to play a Chopin nocturno, which is like one bar a week. But you know, it was other type of quarantine, self quarantining. That kind of sensation of the bass lines and the melody that, you know, you have something moving, but yet when Chopin had his music, it's like almost like free melody,
for sure,
like a horn player would play over a rhythm section. And then, you know, this kind of solitude idea of like, and imagining the horn playing over the bass line. So that's,
were you working on a specific nocturne when you were writing this? Do you remember which one?
Oh God, why you got to pin her down? Come on, Mr. Classical Piano Man.
Curious.
Yes, I will tell you. Yes, I will tell you.
Was it the E flat?
Yes, it was.
Wait, are you talking about, Chopin, a pianist out of Poland?
Yes. Yes, it was.
Young cat, definitely. Young cat. Got the airport named after him.
Cool, that's cool.
Well, it's just called Nocturne. Where is the... Okay, yeah.
They're all just called Nocturne.
But it's an E minor.
Yeah.
E minor.
This is Nocturno by Anat Cohen. Thank you.
I'm gonna tell you guys, pianists out there, study what Rini did at the end there, those last chords. If you transcribe that, you will be far along. You might have a lawsuit from Rini coming your way. That's not my responsibility. But go ahead and study that, because that's some next level type stuff. Beautiful.
Yeah. Gorgeous composition, Anat.
Rini was definitely helping me tweak the arrangement, made the horn much yummier than I imagined. So thank you, Rini, for that.
And Noriko, beautiful solo.
Yeah, yes. until Anat cut her off. I mean, what's up with that? Jeez.
Sorry.
It was like the
it did sound to me like I cut her off now that I was listening to it.
Yeah.
At the time, I was like, let's keep short solos. And then
that's funny, because that wasn't your concept on your solo, though. Anyway,
I felt like if I saw it was a little bit like play. Let's go.
Glad that you had a great bass solo. I mean, I'm all for cutting off bad bass solo, but she was killing. Come on,
it was so grooving. That was so grooving. No, yeah.
I was done. Definitely. Yeah, my phone was done. And I think we're supposed to trade it or something. And
it was totally confusing, though, wasn't it? Because she's just like you're playing, and then she's all on top. You know? So do I have to trade? Okay, do I go back to baseline? All right, whatever. You're the boss. It's your tune.
Wait, I got the look. I got the when the bass players is doing their thing, and then they get the look that they're done. I got the look.
you might have misinterpreted. All right, anyway.
I remember, we only did a one day for this tune, right? Like a first day?
Yeah.
First day and a first tune and a one take and I'm sorry.
You know what it is.
No. It was beautiful. It was incredible soloing. I mean, it had that one take kind of vibe. And we've all been in those situations before when we had to create that one take vibe on the 11th take, But it is fun when it happens on the one take.
Did we talk about where this was recorded? Where was this recorded?
Yeah, someone was asking that.
Oh my God. I'm going blank right now. It was Mount Vernon. The studio.
You get a free pass because it's a pandemic.
Octaven?
Yes, Octaven. Thank you.
Octaven.
Octaven.
Thank you.
Octaven is. Okay.
Yeah. Fancy.
In Mount Vernon. It's a great studio too.
Yeah, we're going to be recording a little something here coming up there, I think, Peter.
We are. Yeah, with the little pianist named Fred Hirsch. What? Anyway. that's a cool place, and it's a really good, really great piano, as I recall, and as I'm hearing you play right now. Wow. And I'm going to tell you guys, I'm sorry, I don't mean to geek out on Rini so much, but you played so busy at one point. It reminded me of Oscar Peterson, where it's like anyone else playing that, like just background, like the number of notes you played per second for a while was just like, and it was all so great. And I love that. It's like,
on that last tune?
Yeah. I mean, there was just some little flurries that you did, like where most pianists would have made it, just do. And I love that. And it was all so well placed and just perfect.
Thank you.
Yeah.
They don't call it a supergroup for nothing, Peter Martin. You know that.
Yeah, and I wanted to ask you guys. I mean, of course, everyone's talks about the all female group, but it's also like this is a very unique group. You have a very international flair here because it's almost entirely outside. Because someone was on here there was a little north of the border love for you, Rini, I think.
Oh, okay.
From somebody was saying something about up north, giving you some Canadian thing that I didn't quite understand. You guys have the secret.
It was like North Van or something.
North Van.
Vancouver. Yeah. Vancouver. Okay, that's North Vancouver. Okay. Yeah.
I can recognize it, but I don't know what it is. But everybody except Cecile and Allison are both U.S. or American.
Yeah.
Right? The rest of the band, international, all from different places around the world, which is super exciting. Is this news to you guys? You guys act surprised. Did you not know that? I mean, did that factor into anything?
Are you just realizing?
No, I think it's a really cool kind of unique thing with this
group.
It
is pretty unique, yeah.
And that wasn't purposely done either,
It wasn't. Okay.
No.
Right. Because I know Anat has had some immigration issues. I don't know if she's gotten that taken care of. We'll talk about that later. She's feeling more secure now that with the new administration, so I'm excited for her with the possibilities that is opening up for her.
Careful. Noriko, this next composition is yours. Yes, step forward.
Yes.
Would you like to tell us a little bit about it?
It's called Step Forward, and it's jazz waltz, and featuring everyone in a band, and please listen.
Does it not let you solo on your own tune?
I tried to play two solos, but really didn't let me.
Here's Step Forward.
Thank you.
I love that ending.
Yeah, that was so tight and just great ensemble playing.
Peter. Cats.
Yeah, so good. Look at this, Peter. Woo! Unicorn pocket.
That was a unicorn pocket, you guys.
We made it happen.
You guys definitely hit the unicorn pocket on that one. Woo! Yeah, great writing.
Yeah, amazing photos. Oh, thank you.
Yeah, beautiful. The horn writing, the beautiful melodies, the groove, the solo. Awesome. So you guys being amazing players individually, and this group being so interesting, and you all being, you know, great writers, and many of you, if not all of you, band leaders in your own right, and stars and beautiful ladies, were featured in a lot of press. But I just want to throw this up and have you guys talk about this photo session. Bam, that's from Vanity Fair.
What?
Hello. I love this picture, and I remember when this article came out, I was like, okay, I know all of them, and none of them are going to talk to me again after this, because they're in Vanity Fair.
That's gorgeous.
Yeah, how do we get it so that, anyway, okay, there you go. So you guys can go check out them.
Wait.
How did that picture, you guys all together, or did they piece that together? That's what I
know. We were together. Yeah.
Okay. That's such a cool picture. Do you guys like it?
Yeah, there were several.
Go ahead.
There were several from the shoot. And I don't know whether you saw that issue, but there were a lot of different women musicians featured in it. So in the article.
Who was the photographer? It was a great
Philip Montgomery. See, I remember him, but I remember the studio name. Yeah, no, he's an amazing award-winning photographer. He's done a lot of work for the New York Times, and he's a freelancer, but I think Vanity Fair has used him a lot over the years. He's an incredible photographer. He came in with a real concept. He was looking for kind of like he had some pictures of old I don't even know, photo shoots from days gone by of people. I don't know who they were, like maybe some old Hollywood shoots. And with the shadows, he was really trying to go for the shadows. So he had all this lighting to try and achieve that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's got the film noir, old Hollywood look. I love, he captured everybody's expression, and yeah, it's cool. Good stuff. Should we hear some more?
Yeah, Cry Butter Cry. I didn't really know this tune before this album came out. Does anybody have anything to say about this tune and why?
It was written by a man named Rocco Acetta, and he wasn't that well known. He was actually from New Jersey. And the most famous recording, or perhaps the only other recording of it, I'm not sure, is Maxine Sullivan, the great vocalist. I think it appealed to Cecile, and so we decided to put it on the album.
Let's hear it.
So So have no regrets and just learn to forget how to cry, little buttercup, cry.
That's just good advice.
That is. That's just basic life. That's basic life 101. Come on. Cecile is such an amazing vocalist. Her voice, her instrument is just obviously exquisite. But I think she's such a songstress, but a lover of song and knows how to pick songs that work for her and that she can really take the lyric and go with. And I love that about her. I think that she used that so well with this track. And I just got to say, everybody sounded great, but that was a classic killer Anat. You sound great on this whole record, but that solo, that's like classic Anat. You know, where you started, where you went, and beautiful stuff. Just beautiful.
I agree.
Thank you. And I love the, of course, I love it when Cecile sings, anything she sings, you know, if I remember, I come in the right place with the band, but the way Rini captures, you know, give her the, the whole scenario to sing in, and the way it really directed us, and the fact that we all played 8-bar solos or 16-bar solos, like really short and condensed, made everything, it flows so, you get a flavor of everybody playing, and it's just, I love this arrangement. This song is one of my favorite ever.
It's great.
Yeah, I thought everybody's solos on it were just gorgeous.
Mm-hmm.
I get goosebumps when I hear Cecile anyway, but in my headphones especially.
Yeah.
And talking about you know, when we talked about having one take of Nocturno, I mean, this song, we had one take. I mean, we started another take, and it was a false, nobody really knew where it's going, and that was the only take actually that we have is complete. So, yeah. And Cecile singing live, it's not like, you know, some overdubbing singers. She's singing with the band, and then she's like, go back.
Yeah, she's not isolated at all. She's in the room with all of us. She doesn't need to do any overdubs.
But of course, she didn't talk to you at all. You're not allowed to talk to her, though. Only to make music with her, of course.
Oh, right. We can't look at
her. You can't look her in the
eye. Like Barbara Streisand?
Yeah, exactly.
Rini, are you conscious about that flow when... you know, the difference between a vocal arrangement and an instrumental arrangement when there's text involved? Are you conscious of keeping that story on the front of the
listener's
mind?
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely.
It's great.
I was just thinking about your solo on Anat, 16 bars. It's even more impressive. Like, you started so, you know, folks, and this doesn't matter if you play clarinet, you play piano, anything, bass, you know, check out the way when you go back and listen to this album, the way Anat started that solo, because a lot of times when you have 16 bars, it's the opposite of starting patient. It's like, oh, I could just... Anat started that solo like she had 616 measures to go. That's the way she played the first phrase. And so that's a pro tip for you. Start even your short solos like it's going to be a long solo. Be patient, take your, you know, be confident with what you're doing like Anat. You'll be all right.
So we'll end with the Sidewinder here, and then we'll wrap it up afterwards. Sometimes we go out with the last track, but I'd love to just have a bit of send off here.
If everybody's available, if anyone's got a gig to go to or something,
feel free to split.
I understand. If you got to go, you got to go. You know.
Rini, you brought in this chart. It says. So, what was your thought with bringing in the Sidewinder to the old Blue Note session here?
I just thought it'd be fun to include a piece with a nod to Blue Note. And actually, we also recorded an extra track of a Lee Morgan piece, truth be told, for an album that I believe Blue Note will release at some point, of kind of newer reimaginings of classic Lee Morgan songs.
Cool.
So I had kind of written Sidewinder for that purpose. And then I found out that another musician had already taken that song. So I went back to the drawing board to look for another one, which I think we did the Procrastinator, right? It was we recorded that as well, which hopefully people will hear one day. But anyway, so then I thought, hey, well, let's put Sidewinder on the record. It makes perfect sense. And it's a great, I thought it was a great ending piece.
Agreed. Let's check it out. Here's the Sidewinder. Thank you. That is slick.
Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful.
Yeah.
What a great arrangement.
Yeah.
And great execution. I love your kind of nod on your solo. You had a little nod. Well, there's a lot of nod to the original, but you played a big part of it, as far as I could tell, in the vibe and the tempo, like the meter of the original, right? You like the almost like a double time kind of feel. It reminded me of that, floating above that great groove that you wrote.
You talking about me?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I guess it's in there by osmosis, so that's very likely.
such great playing. What a vibe.
Man, what a great spot I have in the house to be right between Melissa Aldana and Ingrid Jensen, you know, to get like, they're so inspiring and, you know, they're always like, there's always a surprise, right? You play with home players and you think, I know where it's going. And it's always like, oh, really? Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
like, it's so great. They're so awesome.
Well, yeah. And when you're on the bass clarinet, you and Melissa, it's like a whole nother thing. It's a whole nother conversation. And does it feel different than when you're playing with her on the regular clarinet because you're more in the register? Or like,
yeah.
is it a conscious thing?
Yeah, you can't, you know, when you, it's, you know, she, I can't be rude on the clarinet, but I can be rude on the bass clarinet. And she has a lot of nerve. So you know, right, you gotta go with answer with some nerve, and you know, the clarinet is less accepting that, but the bass clarinet lets you go like,
excuse me, I got sound too. So the bass clarinet actually goes lower than the tenor saxophone, right?
Yeah,
it can go down lower.
Okay. Yeah,
it's a bass, Peter. The bass in the right there in the title of the instrument.
Well, Nori can go below all of them. She's not worried about that. That's really? The real bass. It really go down lower.
Yeah.
Well, thank you all so much for joining us. Thank you, Rini, Anat, and Noriko. Just so great to talk with you and listen to your beautiful music. Just an amazing album. I think one of the best of 2020. And
for sure
did feel great to listen to it tonight.
Well, yeah, thank you for having us.
We
had a great time. So wonderful to see my bandmates again, and great to see you guys too. So thank you so much.
And special shout out to Cecile and Ingrid and Allison and Melissa for their amazing playing too.
Yeah, thanks a lot for joining us, guys. We appreciate the other ones that didn't show up, but we love these that do even more. No, we're just kidding. Yeah, congratulations everybody for just an amazing project. And I would just say everybody, thanks everybody for coming and listening as always every Tuesday. And you know, this is one of those albums we always talk about. This, I mean, feel free to of course stream it. It's available Spotify and Apple Music and all that stuff. But this
Get
is a good
vinyl
one to pick
going
up.
Though, you know,
is this on vinyl? Is this
yeah?
Oh,
vinyl.
Come on! How do I get
be
a promo
one of our
copy?
First spins.
What's happening?
And when we get our vinyl listening space together, this should be one of our first spins.
We're gonna have you guys back.
I got a mini vinyl copy.
There you go.
Brazilian. That's called Brazilian vinyl. It's not a Brazilian wax. It's Brazilian vinyl. No, so it's like this is a great one to pick up on CD or whatever. I mean, listen to it however you want, but as you see, and as I really saw tonight, I think we all felt that this album going from beginning to end is a special thing, especially when me and Adam aren't talking in the middle. So thank you guys so much for the music and for, as always, your spirit. And I miss you guys. I love you very much, and I'm looking forward to seeing you and hugging you in person and making music again.
We love you too.
Artemis,
yeah, you
everybody.
Guys. Thank
give
you for all
Artemis.
You're doing for jazz and for our inspiration.
Yeah.
All right, give it up, Artemis.
Artemis, yeah, can't wait to see this band again live. Peter, next week we have Jeffrey Keyser is joining us again because he wants to listen to something
who?
Specifically. Jeffrey
who,
Keyser.
Who is that? What is
he's
that?
He's a pianist.
Bass player?
Pianist. He's got two really great hands. And he wants to listen to.
I've heard him before.
Newborn
he's
a junior, so yeah, he's okay. He's okay.
Yeah. Well, Artemis, thanks, you guys can come back anytime. Keith can come too, but you guys are welcome every week. So
thanks, everybody. Have a great night. We'll see you tomorrow.
Bye.
Good night, everybody.
Bye.